sing and worship him together.
Joy to the world.
I'm going to say good morning. It's not good morning. Good night. Hello. We're glad that you're here. You know, this is one of my favorite times of year for the weatherman to be wrong. And so, you know, I feel like the last couple days could have been much worse. And it was, you know, it was definitely cold. But I was glad to see not as much snow as maybe we were expecting. But we are glad to be here and to be able to worship and to be able to celebrate Christmas Eve with you all. I only have a couple of announcements. The first one is that if you're a first-time guest with us, in the chair in front of you, there should be a card. This is our Connect card. It's just a way for us to get information so we can get you connected with the church and make sure that you have any information that you need about the church and things that we have coming up and different things like that. So if you would like, you could fill that out. It can also be used for prayer requests. If you have anything that you would like us to be praying for, please write that down. You can drop it in the box in the back, give it to Josh or I after service, and we would love to be praying for those things. The only other announcement that I have is tomorrow is Christmas Day, but we want to continue to worship, and so we will have our regular 10 a.m. service tomorrow morning, and we want to invite you to all come and come back and to worship with us. I think it's a little more casual, a little bit more laid back tomorrow than maybe tonight, and so I think there's even some families that may be wearing matching PJs. So, which should be exciting. But let me pray, and then we will continue to worship tonight. Dear God, we thank you. We just thank you that we are able to gather in this place with everybody, with friends and family, and maybe some people we've never met before. But we are united tonight to celebrate the most amazing gift that you've given our world, and that was your son. And so we just want to lift up praise to you, God, for the way that you have orchestrated everything to come to be, and to celebrate that your son came to this world. God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumphs of the skies. Angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. As men with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Hail in heaven.
Hail in heaven, Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lay his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Amen. Amen.
sing on, ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord.
Amen, amen. Isaiah 7:14 says, "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel." Isaiah prophesied this long, long before the birth of Jesus took place. Jesus was God's plan from the very beginning. We were not able to save ourselves, so God sent his son, Emmanuel, so that we would be saved. He came to dwell among us. So therefore, let's continue to praise him this morning for that precious gift that he has given us.
What hope we hold this starting night. A king is born in Bethlehem. Our journey long, we seek the night that leads to the hallowed manger ground. What fear we felt in the silent age. 400 years, can he be found? But broken by a baby's cry, rejoice in the hallowed manger ground. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God incarnate, here to to bleed. A crown of thorns would pierce his brow, and we beheld this offering exalted now. The King of Kings, praise God for the hallowed manger ground.
Emmanuel.
guys may be seated.
I had to stop myself just there because I almost said good morning. Merry Christmas. Now, the center of my year, there's one moment that's kind of the center of my year that I feel every year probably the closest to God. And it's silly that it's this moment or whatever that has such a profound emotional effect on me. But every year, it's the Christmas Eve service. And no matter where I am, specifically the point in the service when we light candles and sing Silent Night. That moment of seeing a community with their faces lit up by candlelight singing this beautiful hymn, 200-year-old hymn, for some reason just, like, I weep. And it's funny because if you know me, you know I am not a traditional dude, like, by any means. Like, my call to ministry came from, like, it came to me in the world of, like, playing punk rock shows in South Chicago. Like, the whole reality of, like, traditional hymns and candlelight services is very not my personality. But for some reason, there's a moment every year when I see the crowd lit by candles singing this hymn that I feel in that moment, it's like heaven opens up and I get to see God in a new way every single year, and it's amazing. See, there's something about this song, Silent Night. You see, we've been in this series as a church that we're kind of going through several weeks kind of leading up to today. We've been talking about Christmas carols and talking about kind of the meaning behind the Christmas carols and looking at the real biblical understanding that came underneath that hymn that we sing every year. And it makes sense then that today I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about the song Silent Night. See, the song Silent Night is an interesting song. It was actually first written in 1818 in Germany, Stille Nacht, which is in German, Silent Night. And it's one of those songs where the words were written by one guy and the music was written by another. The words were written by a guy whose name is Franz Gruber. And if you're like me, I hear that and I immediately think Die Hard. Hans Gruber was the bad guy in Die Hard. So I'm like, yeah, Franz, okay, awesome. And then the music was Joseph Moore. And this was originally going to be composed for the organ, but there was this interesting situation in the church, Christmas Eve, 1818, where floodwaters had actually damaged the organ the night of the first performance. And so, kind of on a last-minute thing, they rearranged the song for guitar. Now, there's a rumor, pretty widely held rumor, but never proven by any historian that I've read, that actually the damage to the organ was on purpose by the song's writer because he wanted the song to be played on guitar and not organ, which I think I don't condone damaging church property, but that's kind of punk rock and awesome to me. So that makes this, like, this hymn, this 200-year-old hymn that we sing every year that we think of as, like, this traditional moment, was one of the first worship songs regularly played in churches by guitar. I just think that's interesting. But yeah, it was originally written for the guitar. The lyrics to this song are interesting, though. The lyrics paint this picture of inspiring reverence, silent night, holy night. Reverence for the birth of God in human form. There's these image after image of awe, these radiant beams coming from thy holy face. Heavenly hosts sing alleluia. All revolving around this idea of this silent holy night. Now note, the whole idea of the night of the nativity being quiet is almost definitely artistic license. It doesn't say anywhere in the Bible that it was a silent night. The Bible never says anything about Mary or Jesus being abnormally quiet in those moments. And anyone who has a basic understanding of both infants and childbirth understand that it's probably not quiet. Joyful, stressful, life-changing, amazing, not quiet. Not to mention they're surrounded by, like, you know, sheep and goats, and those aren't quiet either. But these ideas of silence and awe were put there in this song to give this sense of otherworldliness, to make this moment of standing in the presence of God seem unique and different. And so they express that through silence, through this otherworldliness, this otherness of standing in this incredibly important moment. It's to make us stop and notice something profound in that moment. You see, it's the combination of these two images that make this night, this song, and this thought so unbelievably world-shattering. The glory of God coming to earth, Emmanuel, God with us, the King of Kings, come to change the world, born as a helpless baby, placed in a feeding trough. That's what a manger is. It's a feeding trough, placed among livestock. Grandeur and humility, glory and shame, power and weakness, both together in one song, in one world-changing moment of the birth of our King. You see, undergirding this idea of the nativity, undergirding this idea of understanding the birth of our God, we need to first understand the people that Jesus was born into. Jesus was born into the kingdom around Israel. Israel, we know Israel now. But at the time, Israel was a conquered people for centuries. Centuries and centuries. They were ruled by the Babylonians, by the Persians. They were conquered by Alexander the Great at one point, and finally the Romans. They haven't ruled themselves in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And these were the people that had this mission in their DNA, this mission in their family of bringing the reality of God to the world, yet they were like always ruled by someone else for generation upon generation upon generation upon generation, always under the thumb of the larger empires, always dreaming of returning to the time when they can rule themselves. And so they yearned for that moment. And sure enough, God kept giving them strength, giving them hope for the future, and gave them prophecy after prophecy, leading to the time when they would be free. And we read this in Isaiah 9. We'll have it on the screen behind me here for you. Isaiah 9, chapter 6. For to us a child is born. To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and with righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. See, the people of God were waiting on a ruler that would come and free them from their mess, from this broken identity of being the people of God, always under the thumb of someone else. God promised a Savior, a Messiah, or in Greek, a Christ, to come and save the people of God from their struggle. But the interesting twist in the Christmas story and in our gospel understanding of Jesus is that we aren't simply talking about a political salvation of independence. We're not talking about borders on a map. We're talking about something far more profound. We're talking about an everlasting Father, a place where greatness and peace will have no end, a place where justice and righteousness reign from that time and forever, is what the scripture says. So we're talking about eternity. The Savior wasn't coming simply to give the people their own country with mundane borders and mundane understanding. He was coming to open the door of heaven itself, to acknowledge the inherent value in every single soul and invite them, invite every single person into an eternal existence where we can be exactly who we were made to be, without the petty struggles of this world. Jesus coming into the world, this Messiah, this Savior, was our promised hope, our promised invitation into eternity. That was the promise. And then we see that prophecy fulfilled. Luke 1, this is when the angel comes to Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called Son of the Most High. And the Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How can this be?" Mary asked the angel. "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." And sure enough, God's prophecy is fulfilled. A Savior, God himself, Emmanuel, comes into this world, a child destined for glory beyond any other, a king of kings, but born to a virgin, placed in a stable, raised by a carpenter. Here we have that combination of images that look like opposites to us. This grandeur and humility, glory and shame, power and weakness, all together in the image of God on earth. The most perfect person to ever walk the planet. The culmination of centuries of hope and promises. The King of Kings, the ultimate authority of power. Of an omnipotent God in human form, presented to us as a poor, homeless, helpless baby. See, for me, this image of the helpless baby Jesus is quite possibly the most profound illustration of what the gospel is, what the good news of Jesus is, and why we are all here today. It's the most profound thing I can imagine. We often, in today's world, we get caught up in these false battles between power and weakness. We strive to be perfect, to be right, to win. We want to be the smartest. We want to be the strongest. We want to be the most successful. We systematically try to cut out anything that work against these images. We lean on our strengths. We celebrate our pride. We collect prestige and wealth and anything else that lends the appearance of power. We even appropriate the images of God to go about this. We see this all the time. Jesus was tough, so I should be tough. God was powerful, so I should be powerful. And you're right. God is powerful. Jesus is tough. He flipped tables and cracked whips. But he also chose weakness. All the power on earth and in heaven, all the power in the universe, all the authority in the universe, and he chose to appear broken. And he chose to come as a homeless infant, not a conquering king. The man who commanded armies of angels allowed himself to be hung on a cross for my sake, for your sake. Yes, God is tough, God is powerful, God is strong, but he's also unbelievably and incredibly humble. God is forgiving. God is sacrificial. God is loving. God is kind. He had all the power and all the strength in the universe, but he chose weakness, or at least the appearance of that. Philippians 2 illustrates this in Scripture. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, or as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. He became obedient to death, even death on a cross. We don't have to be strong. God is already strong. We no longer have to fear weakness. We don't have to be tough. God is tough. We no longer have to fear being vulnerable. We don't have to be rich. Everything, everywhere belongs to God. We no longer have to fear poverty. That's the awe-inspiring message in the helpless infant baby Jesus. All the power chooses weakness. John 3:16 and 17 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Jesus didn't come into the world for condemnation and judgment. Jesus didn't come in to point out all our flaws and to set these people aside as these are the right ones and they need to feel good and strong and powerful. Jesus came into the world to flip this on its head so that we no longer have to fear being weak. Because Jesus himself showed us that weakness is strength. We don't need to be strong because he is strong. We don't need to fear weakness. He came into the world to free us from the struggle of having to be perfect. Jesus came into this world to offer us freedom from that ever-present pressure of being good enough. Not because we are somehow amazing, not because we're strong enough or rich enough or pious enough or whatever enough, not because of any of that. He was all of those things. And he made it so that we never have to fear about being enough ever again. That is the glory of the gospel. We never have to fear being enough. Because he's enough. Because he is the strong one. He is the powerful one. He is the loving one. He is the good one. And he claims us. So we stand with awe and wonder, and in some cases, silence. That's the image of this night. Power and weakness. So how do we respond to the freeing power of our Savior? Well, there's several ways, okay? We can celebrate our new freedom, gather together and carve out joy amongst the coldest and darkest nights because we know that the cold and darkness have been beaten forever. Amen? Amen. We can model that same merciful grace, that same humility among every single person we meet, leading with our weakness, leading with our vulnerability and our love, because God's got us. Amen? Amen. And we never forget the value that God has placed on each and every one of us as his children by claiming us as his and offering us an invitation to be with him simply because he loves you. Jesus told us one way to respond. See, on this night in Passover, the night of Passover, about 33 years after Jesus was laid in that feeding trough on that silent night, Jesus gathered his disciples together for one last meal. We read about it, actually. 1 Corinthians says this: the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Ever since that night, 2,000 years ago, every time that the people of God gather, we participate in a symbolic meal as a way to remember the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, as a way to remember the healing power he has, as a way to remember this power and weakness combined. And so we celebrate together in remembrance of him. So here in a few minutes, to end this, we're actually going to have you come up, and we're going to respond to the presence of Jesus through this symbolic meal. So we actually have stations up here with communion ready to go. And so in a few minutes, I'm going to invite you to come on up at your own pleasure, at your own comfort, to come on up and to take communion here from these trays. We have two cups stacked. The bottom one has the bread and the top one has the juice. And that bread is to remind us of Jesus' body broken for us, that he came into this world. He had all the power in the world, but he chose to be broken for our sake. And the cup of the juice is to remember that Jesus' blood was shed for us. Again, all the power in the world, but he chose to sacrifice himself for us. And so I'm going to invite you guys to come on up and take communion here. And go ahead and take communion back to your seat. You can also see bins here with candles, because you can't have me talking about Silent Night and candlelight. We're going to do this tonight. Oh, yeah. And so when you come up to grab communion, go ahead and grab a candle. All the adults, grab a candle and head back to your seat. And we'll bring the light to you here in a little bit. But right now, I want to invite you to pray with me. And then let's share this communion meal together. Dear Jesus, God, you are this amazing image for us of power and weakness, power through weakness, strength coming from something so small, so helpless, choosing weakness. It's profound. Because of you, we never have to fear being enough ever again. Because of you, we can be fulfilled, understanding that no matter what this world throws at us, no matter whether it's the coldest, darkest night, the God of the universe loves us enough to die on our behalf. Power and weakness. God, thank you. Bless this time as we come together and celebrate you, celebrate the gift that you have offered us by coming into our world, by living our life, by paying our price. God, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. When you're comfortable, go ahead and step forward. When you're comfortable, go ahead and step forward and grab communion from these stations.
watching from a hill. I close my eyes and see the night when love was born. Perfect child and gently waits a mother. Bends to kiss God's face. I close my eyes and see the night when love was born. Angels fill the midnight sky.
Everybody should have gotten a candle here. A second. Everybody get one? All right. In a second here, what we're going to do is we're going to pass the light down while we're singing Silent Night. And there's a beautiful image here of the light of Jesus, of a single light. By the way, this light lit Jed's candle. So it was a single light that ultimately will end up lighting up the room as it spreads from person to person. And there's a beautiful image there of something so small, so beautiful, actually changing a space in its entirety. So we're going to get singing here in a second. We're going to be passing the light as we sing. Obviously, be careful if kids are present. You found some battery-powered lights as well. But we're going to pass the light down, and we're going to be singing Silent Night. All right. Here we go.
Let's stand as we close the service. All is bright. the sight. Glory stream from heaven afar. Heavenly hosts sing alleluia. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
Let's pray. Dear God, we give glory to you this night. Power in the smallest package. We celebrate because we know even in the coldest, darkest days, you have beaten the cold and the dark. God, you are good. And we are so grateful that because of you, we will never have to be enough again because you got us. In Jesus' name, amen. Merry Christmas. See you tomorrow for worship, guys.
Hey. How's it going there? It's going? Oh, yeah. Okay, that is cool, man. Very cool. That's good stuff, bro. How is it just, is it like a 4-year degree you're doing? what are your lifeguard? Have you thought about what you're gonna do? Or you're just kind of playing a step by step. Yeah. I'm in like super far southern Missouri in Joplin. That's where I'm going to school. Small Bible college. So I'm going for worship ministry actually. So it's been good.